Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. So on this morning of Vijayadashami day, marking the end of the Navaratri festival, start my second lecture on the Taittiriya Upanishad and its Bhashya by Adishankara Bhagavatpada. But this will be the first lecture that actually gets into the text and into the details. So, usually we see in Indian philosophical texts that the author typically starts off with an auspicious verse, with either a prayer to his or her personal deity, or a salutation to their guru, naming who they are, who the gurus are, and things like that. You will see in Adishankara Bhagavatpada's commentaries that this is kept at a minimum no-nonsense level. The Taittiriya Upanishad Bhashya of Adishankaracharya begins with salutations, but he provides really no clue as to his own name or his teacher's name or his lineage of preceptors. He just salutes them in a general fashion, paying obeisance to all his previous acharyas in the lineage. So he starts off with three verses. The first one says, Yasmat jatam jagat sarvam yasmin eva praliyate yenidam dhatyate chaiva tasmai jnanatmane namaha. So this again is a nod to the ultimate teaching presented in the Taittiriya Upanishad, which we referred to in the previous lecture. Yatova imani bhuta nijayante ye najata nijivanti yat prayanti abhisambishanti. That definition or description of Brahman as the source, sustenance and the goal of all beings, which is at the beginning of the Bhrigu, Valli, the third chapter of the Taittiriya Upanishad, is what Shankaracharya's salutation refers to right in the very first verse. Yasma jatan jagat sarvam, that from which the whole jagat, the whole universe is born. Yasmin neva praliyate, that in which it gets resolved. Ye nedam dharyate chaiva, yena idam dharyate cha eva, yena idam dharyate chaiva. That by which all of this is sustained, upheld, dharyate, is dhara, is to hold, to uphold. Tasmai jnanatmane namaha. Now this principle that is the source, the sustenance and the end goal of all the universe is referred to as jnanatma. The Atma that is Brahman, the Self that is the ultimate reality, which is Jnana, knowledge, consciousness. To that ultimate reality, Shankaracharya says Namaha, salutations. The second verse, Yairime Gurubhif Purvam Padavakya Pramanataha Vyakhyatas Sarva Vedantas Tan Nityam Pranatosmiham. Yairime Gurubhihi. By these gurus, Vyakhyata Sarva Vedantaha, all the Vedantas have been explained. How? Purvam Padavakya Pramanataha, in the past, with an examination of the Pramanas of Pada and Vakya. Pada is word by word and Vakya is sentence by sentence. So the previous teachers in the Vedanta lineage, who came before Shankaracharya, are referred to here as having explained all the Vedantas, Sarva Vedanta Vyakhyataha, with a close examination of the texts, word by word and sentence by sentence, Padavakya Pramana. Tan Nityam Pranatosmiham, those gurus I salute, always. In fact, as we go through the commentary, we will see that Shankaracharya also takes great pains to explain his stance on every word and every sentence as much as possible. Unless something is so obvious that it doesn't need explanation, he never skips over even things like explanations of grammar. We will notice that as we go through this discussion. The third verse, Taittiriya kasarasya maya acharya prasadataha vispashtartha ruchinam hi vyakhyayam sampraniyate. So, maya acharya prasadataha. So, he is referring to his own acharya. And he is saying, maya vyakhya iyam sampraniyate. I am offering this explanation with my own acharya's blessing, acharya prasadataha. And this explanation brings out the essence of the Taittiriya. Taittiriya kasarasya vyakhya iyam. So this explanation of the essence of the Taittiriya, and by Taittiriya here he refers only to the Taittiriya Upanishad, not the entire Taittiriya branch of the Krishna Yajurveda. Vispashtartha ruchina, for the benefit of those who delight in vispashtartha, clear, lucid meaning, the detail oriented, clear and lucid meaning. For those who prefer vispashtartha ruchi, those who have ruchi, those who have a taste for this sort of a detailed meaning, so for their benefit, he is composing this Taittiriya Bhashya. Shankaracharya also prefaces his introduction to the Taittiriya Upanishad commentary with a fairly extensive introduction. I won't go through the whole introduction except to say that in this introduction he examines the relationship between karma and jnana and makes it very clear that jnana or knowledge is the only source to moksha. And karma has its place for those who are interested in the fruits of karma. But moksha, that is liberation, is through jnana alone. And Shankaracharya is a very firm proponent of the view that one does not mix these two on the road to moksha. In the ultimate analysis, liberation or moksha is solely through knowledge alone, and works, action, has to be left behind at some point. Those philosophers who say that man is always a doing animal and he can never refrain from doing action, and therefore the road to moksha also must be combined with action till one's last moment, that stance is wrong. It is not that action can just be renounced willy-nilly, but at the right stage, at a certain step along the path towards moksha, Shankaracharya is insistent that action has to be left behind. And that is why sannyasa is a very key feature in the Shankaracharya tradition. He does not talk much about that in this introduction. He focuses all his comments on moksha being eternal and not the fruit of any action, and therefore it is just a simple logical corollary, it's just a logical conclusion that as moksha is never the fruit of an action, action cannot be a direct means to moksha. Knowledge is the only direct means that opens the door of liberation. And ultimately, what is this moksha? Svatman yavasthanam. Avidya kama karmopadana hetu nivrittau svatman yavasthanam moksha. Avidya kama karma. So all karma eventually starts off from a seed of kama, desire, and the root of kama, desire, is avidya. These are the hetus, the causes for samsara. In the nivritti of that, hetu nivrittau, swatmanyavasthanam mokshaha. When these factors that are the cause for samsara are gone or have been taken away, one abides in one's own self. One abides in the self. Swatmani avasthanam, swatmanyavasthanam. That is liberation. Swayanchatma Brahma. These are sentences that occur towards the end of his introduction. The Atma, the self itself, is Brahma. Swayamcha Atma Brahma. That which we call the innermost Atma, the self, is Brahman. Tadvijnana davidya nivritti. Through knowledge of that self, ignorance, avidya, is taken away. So once avidya is gone, then the self abides in itself, and that is liberation. So knowledge is what is directly opposed to ignorance, and therefore knowledge is the only ultimate means to moksha. Having said this, the introduction to the Taittiriya Upanishad commentary also says, Upanishad, the word Upanishad means Vidya. Upanishad iti vidyochyate. So, Upanishad, the word Upanishad itself means knowledge, Vidya. We saw in the previous lecture that the Upanishad itself is praised as Devata. Sagamiti Upanishad Devata. Varuni Upanishad Devata. So the Upanishad themselves are talked of as Devatas. Upanishad, the word itself, means Vidya, knowledge. So in his commentaries across the Brahma Sutra and multiple Upanishads and the Gita, Shankaracharya never derives the word Upanishad the way it is normally done today. If you pick up a standard book on Vedanta or Indian philosophy, you will see Upa plus Ni plus Sad being referred to as the student sitting at the teacher's feet. Upa plus Ni plus the root Sad is identified with sitting near. That is not the etymology given for the word Upanishad in any of Shankaracharya's commentaries, to my knowledge. What he does say is Upanishad itself means Vidya. Tatsevinam garbhajanmajaradi nishatanat tadavasadanadva brahmana upanigama yitrutvat. So the prefixes upa and ni are explained in this way. For those who resort to this Upanishad, tat sevinam garbhajanmajaradi nishatanat. Nishatanat means expelling. Of garbhajanmajaradi, the cycle of births and growing old and dying and coming back to birth. So those who resort to the Upanishad are taken away from this cycle, which is what we call samsara. Tadavasadhanadva brahmana upanigamayitrutvat. That takes you towards Brahman. Upanigama. Okay. Upanishanamva asyam param shreya iti. So those who do this, they have the param shreya, the ultimate good. Tadarthatvad. Because of that meaning, Granthopyupanishad. The text itself is also called Upanishad. So here, Shankaracharya is clearly referring to the content of the teaching. The Vidya, the knowledge, is Upanishad. And insofar as that teaching is encapsulated in this text is also called the Upanishad. So the primary referent of the word Upanishad is not merely a text, but it is the core content of the teaching that is conveyed through that text. So the text gains its title as an Upanishad because it is the means to convey that knowledge. Therefore, what is primary is knowledge. What is primary is the content that is taught in the Upanishad. And the Upanishad that we think of normally as the name of a text is actually, it derives its name by being the vehicle of that knowledge. So what I would request my listeners to do is to keep this constantly in the back of your minds. When we talk of Vedanta and we say the Upanishads, we primarily seem to refer to texts. The text is a thing that stands outside. Whereas when you say knowledge, it is something that we internalize. It becomes our own. And in Shankaracharya's worldview, it is that knowledge that is primarily Upanishad. The text is the vehicle to convey that knowledge. And the text becomes pramana, it becomes the source of that knowledge because it has been handed down from those who have achieved this knowledge themselves to us. In every generation, the teaching is conveyed through the text, and it is because of being the vehicle of that teaching that the text itself is called the Upanishad. So in the next 10 or 15 minutes, I will quickly go through the first Shanti Patha and the first Anuvaka of the Shiksha Valli, which is the first chapter of the Taittiriya Upanishad. As you all know, the Taittiriya Upanishad has the Shiksha Valli, the Brahmananda Valli, and the Bhrigu Valli. In the beginning of the Shiksha Valli, there is always a Shanti Patha. Channo Mitra Shambharunaha. Before the Brahmananda Valli, there is a Shanti Patha, Sahana Bhavatu. Now, Shankaracharya does not neglect to explain even the Shanti Pathas. He does not merely say that, oh, my focus is on the Brahma Vidya alone, and therefore I don't care about the Shanti Pathas. He never says that. He takes great care to explain word by word, sentence by sentence. So, Pada Vakya Pramanataha, as he himself has talked about his predecessors in the lineage, he also does the same thing. So, the Shanti Patha for the Taittiriya Upanishad is Shanno Mitrasham Varunaha. So, those who know this hymn will most probably have heard it in one version, but in reality, there is a slight variation in the patham that is prevalent among different groups of reciters. So, Channo Mitrasyam Varunaha, Channo Bhavatvaryama, Channa Indro Brihaspati, Channo Vishnururukramaha, Namo Brahmane, Namaste Vayo, Tvameva Pratyaksham Brahmasi, Tvameva Pratyaksham Brahma Vadishyami, Ritam Vadishyami, Satyam Vadishyami, Tanmama Vadu, Tadvaktaram Avadu, Avatu Maam, Avatu Vaktaram, Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. This is the Shanti Patha. This is how most people know to recite it. There is a small variation in this patham that is recited by others, and both of them are considered valid readings, and that is in the line that says Tvameva Pratyaksham Brahmasi, Tvameva Pratyaksham Brahma Vadishyami. The variant would be Tvameva Pratyaksham Brahmasi, Tvameva Pratyaksham Brahma Vadishyami. So the second sentence there, it is Tvam, not Tvam. So as we go through the commentary, you will see that in Shankaracharya's text, the word is Tvam, not Tvam. Although that is the minor reading today in terms of the prevalence of reciters, in Shankaracharya's reading, the word is Tvam. And I am told that in the Sayana Bhashya as well, the reading that has been primarily noticed is the word Tvam and not Tvam. The only difference is that Tvam is in the nominative case, referring to you. Tvam is in the accusative case, so that it becomes the object of the sentence, not the subject of the sentence. So, the Upanishad is talking to us about Brahman and Atma. So why does it offer prayers to this multitude of the Veda deities? Mitra, Varuna, Vayu, Vishnu, Aryama. Why are all these, Indra and Brihaspati as well, of course. So why are all these deities being named and saluted here? This is very clear from how Shankaracharya explains the Shantipatha. Sham is Sukham. Happiness, bliss, auspiciousness. Pranavitte rahascha abhimani devata mitra. Mitra is the devata who governs over the pranavritti, so the prana inside the human body. Mitra also governs the day. Anhascha abhimani. Annaha. Ahaha is day. Annaha is of the day. So Mitra is the abhimani devata, the deity who governs over the prana in the human body and the day in the external world. Tathaiva apana vritte ratrescha abhimani devata varuna. In the Vedic hymns, Mitra and Varuna are almost always twin devatas. As day follows night and night follows day, Mitra and Varuna are always together with each other. And that is because Mitra is the deity who governs the day and Varuna is the deity who governs the night. And in terms of the constitution of the human body, in Shankaracharya's explanation, Mitra governs the pranavritti and Varuna governs the apanavritti. I'm presuming a basic knowledge of some of these terms, because the pranas are counted as five: prana, apana, vyana, udana, samana. So Mitra is considered the deity in charge of prana and Varuna the deity in charge of apana. Mitra is the deity in charge of the day and ahaha, and Varuna is the deity in charge of the night, ratri. Ratre abhimani, annaha abhimani is Mitra, ratre abhimani is Varuna. So that refers to Shanno Mitrasham Varunaha. Then the next line is Shanno Bhavat Aryama. Aryama is another solar deity. Aryama is a Vedic deity associated with the sun. And that is brought out in the next explanation. Chakshushi Adityecha Abhimani Aryama. There are many, many references in the Upanishads that will say Sayascha Yam Purushe Yascha Sava Aditye Sa Ekaha. He who is in this Purusha, this human body being, this human body, he who is in the sun, they are the same. This refers to the principle of energy that innervates the whole universe. So that principle that lives in the human body and sustains its life is equated with the principle that that becomes a deity that resides in the sun and provides all the energy and energizes all life on earth. So Chakshushi Adityecha Abhimani Aryama. Bale Indraha. In that strength it is Indra. Vachi Buddhaucha Brihaspatihi. In the speech and the intellect, Buddhi, the deity governing that is Brihaspati. So that explains Aryama, Channa Indro Brihaspatihi, up to that. Channo Vishnu Urukramaha. The next line talks about Vishnu Urukrama. Urukrama is described as Vistirna Kramaha Padayor Abhimani. So Vishnu here is the deity who governs movement, the feet. So Padayor Abhimani, goes back to the ancient story of how Vishnu measured out the heavens and the earth, and therefore gets the name Trivikrama in the later Puranic tradition, but he's called Urukrama in the Veda. Evamadhyā adhyātma devatāḥ shamnaḥ. All of these deities, let them be beneficial to us, good to us. So in this way, Shankara's explanation starts off with every single word being explained. Okay? So, then comes Vayu. Namaste Vayo, Tvameva Pratyaksham Brahmasi. So why is Vayu called as Vayo Namaskaromi Paroksha Pratyakshabhyam Vayureva Abhidiyate? So Vayu is felt across the whole universe. We breathe in, we breathe out, we sense the presence of Vayu although we don't see it. So both through indirect paroksha and direct experience pratyaksha, we sense the presence of Vayu, and we can see that the sun exists in the sky. So looking at the deity of the sun, Mitra and Aryama, would probably be something that we associate as deities associated with the sun. Vayu becomes an unseen deity. So this goes in steps towards the ultimate unseen principle, that is Brahma. So Vayu is called the Pratyaksham Brahma. Vayu is called that principle that then becomes perceptible to us. So as you go through this, the Shankaracharya's commentary here, we realize that he says, Tasmat Tvameva Pratyaksham Brahma Vadishyami. He does not refer to the Tvameva reading at all. He says, inasmuch as we sense you as the perceptible Brahman, therefore, Tvameva Pratyaksham Brahma Vadishyami. I will talk of you alone as the Pratyaksham Brahma, the perceptible Brahman, the perceptible deity here. So when you say, I will talk of you alone, the you there becomes the object of the sentence, and therefore the grammatically correct word to be used is Tvam, and that is the only reading that Shankaracharya notices here. As I mentioned before, both Tvam and Tvam continue to be recited by different groups of reciters, but it is obvious that Shankaracharya is familiar with the reading that says Tvam. The rest of it is simple. I won't go through all of each of those lines. The Shanti Patha refers to the commitment of the reciter to Rita, Satya, Satyam Vadishyami, and a prayer that may that commitment to Rita and Satya protect us. Tan Maam Avatu, Tad Vaktaram Avatu, Avatu Maam, Avatu Vaktaram. May all these deities and my commitment to truth and order and reality, Satyam Vadishyami Tan Maam Avatu, may all of that protect me. Maam Avatu. Avatu Vaktaram, may it protect anyone who speaks that. Tad Vaktaram Avatu, Avatu Maam Avatu Vaktaram. So it's a repetition. Tan Maam Avatu, Avatu Maam. Tad Vaktaram Avatu, Avatu Vaktaram. So it gets repeated twice as a prayer that enforces the commitment of the reciter and any other speaker, praying that may this commitment to truth and reality protect us all. Punarvachanam adarartham. This repetition is to reinforce that respect, that commitment to the truth and to the reality. So that is punarvachanam. So all of this then ends with the Shanti, 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 a commitment to everlasting peace. So with that Shanti Patha, it's getting on to the half an hour mark here. I will stop this particular lecture and we will begin the next lecture with the actual beginning of the text of the Taittiriya Upanishad itself. In terms of textual counting, the Shanti Patha itself is counted as the first Anuvaka, the first section within the Shiksha Valli. The Shiksha Valli gets its name from the fact that the second Anuvaka begins with Shiksham Vyakhya Syamaha. So, in the next lecture, I will take the second and the third Anuvakas of the Taittiriya Upanishad and see how that is explained in the Taittiriya Upanishad Bhashya of Adi Shankara. Thank you.